I know some of you are going to find this hard to believe, but I don't actually think that casting sites are from the devil.
You're a voice actor. You're an entrepreneur. You're a VOpreneur. Welcome to the Everyday VOpreneur Podcast, your guide through the business of voiceover.
The Everyday VOpreneur Podcast is brought to you by the VoiceOver Marketing Playbook. If you've got professional demos, a professional home studio, professional training, and you're still not booking, it's likely due to your marketing. The good news is, we can fix it. The VoiceOver Marketing Playbook is a step-by-step, easy-to-follow marketing course that will give you a clear plan for finding your own leads, building your own client base, and becoming the consistently working voice actor you want to be. The playbook will be available again April 9 through 18 at voiceovermarketingplaybook.com.
Hold for tax.
Not as funny as Conan. Not as cute as Seth Meyers. Not as smart as Colbert. But he's one of us, and that counts for something. Here's Mark Scott, the original Everyday VOpreneur.
What's up, and welcome to another episode of the Everyday VOpreneur Podcast. I'm so excited to have you here. Really looking forward to diving into today's episode. I think that the contents of it may surprise people a little bit, because we're going to talk about casting sites, but not like you sometimes always hear me, or think you hear me, talking about casting sites. There's a big misconception out there that Mark Scott is the anti-casting site guy, and that's actually not necessarily true. I'm more about watching how you're using the casting sites than I am whether or not you're using the casting sites, and that's what we're going to dive into in this episode. Now, before we dive into it, though, I just want to take a minute to say thank you to everybody for all of the downloads. I truly appreciate it. I would love it if you would subscribe on your favorite service. Everyday VOpreneur is available on iTunes, on Stitcher, on Podbean, on Google Play, and on Spotify. You can also always check out episodes at VOpreneur.com. But I would love for you to subscribe so that you never miss another one of these episodes. And I would also be very appreciative if you take the time to leave a review on whichever one of those platforms that you like to listen to the podcast on. So thank you so much for doing that. And with that, let's dive into casting sites. We're going to talk about the good, the bad, and the ugly of casting sites today. Now, my views on casting sites are very misunderstood because people do think that I'm 100% anti-casting sites. So I want to clarify that before we even get started. I do think that casting sites can be a really great tool in your toolbox. Where my challenge comes and where I get frustrated with voice actors is when your entire business model is built exclusively on casting sites. And so when I say that a casting site can be a tool in your toolbox, I mean a casting site can be one tool in your toolbox, not the only tool in your toolbox. You don't see a general contractor showing up to build a house with only a hammer. You should not be trying to build a business with only one tool in your toolbox. And I think that's where voice actors are making the mistake. And that is where I get outspoken on the subject of casting sites. This is your business, okay? As a VOpreneur, this is your business. You are starting a small business, or if you've been doing it for a while, you are running a small business, but it needs to be yours. And if that business is built entirely on the back of somebody else's business, then at that point, it doesn't become your business. Either they become a partner in your business, whether you realize it or think you're allowing it or not, or they have more ownership stake in your business than you do because you've built the entire thing on their model. Let me give you an example of this. VDC, which I'm not going to expand upon that any further. You can figure out who that is. But VDC several years ago was a legitimate casting site. A lot of people were using it with great success. I was using VDC many years ago and had great success on the site. But I knew voice actors that had built upwards of six-figure businesses exclusively on the backs of VDC. And then when the crap hit the fan and VDC got stupid and greedy and started doing all kinds of questionable stuff and, you know, skimming budgets up to, you know, at one point we found evidence that a budget had been skimmed up to 92%, which is significant. All of a sudden, voice actors are like, wait a minute. I don't know that I necessarily want to be on this platform anymore. And then the other thing was that they had noticed that they had a substantial decrease in their income. And the reason that the decrease had taken place in their income was because as VDC started managing projects and skimming the budgets started getting smaller and smaller and smaller for what was actually going to the talent. So now you've got people who were incredibly successful on one casting site who were no longer able to maintain sustainable businesses because the business model had changed. But why should that matter to a voice actor? Well, because the business model for VDC changed, but because you built your business on VDC's back, that means that their changes altered your business and you have no say in it whatsoever. That is not the way that your business should work. You should always have say in the changes and the rules and how they apply to your business. But if you give that much control to an outside entity, you're not going to. You're not going to have that say. And that is why I am such a huge proponent of marketing, because when you do the marketing and you build your own client base, it's yours. It doesn't matter what VDC does. Another prime example is with the relaunch of 123. Let's be honest, that has been a complete dumpster fire, okay? An absolute dumpster fire. And it's been going on for several months now. And I see voice actors every day having 17 fits and a hairy conniption over the dumpster fire that is 123 and how much that's impacting their business and it's making them miserable on a day-to-day basis. And it has no bearing on my life whatsoever because I don't use 123. My business is not built on 123. They can carry on with their dumpster fire and it has no impact on me whatsoever. One day, 123 is going to get it sorted out. Maybe. I think there's other things going on behind the scenes, but I'm not going to dive into that here. But ultimately, one day, I think 123 may get it sorted out. And if they do at that point, maybe I'll revisit it. But for now, while the dumpster fire is still actively burning, I have no vested interest in what is going on, and it has no bearing and no impact on my business whatsoever. I'm a happier guy because of that. This is why you have to be so smart about how you choose to use casting sites. You can't build your entire voiceover business exclusively on casting sites because you are giving away too much control. So throughout this episode, I'm going to share some of my thoughts on casting sites, but I also want to paint a slightly different picture just to prove that I do believe that there are times, places, instances where casting sites can absolutely come into benefit. And that is where I'm going to reach out to some everyday VOpreneurs to get their take on the issue. And the very first one I want to start with is, you know, we just talked about 123 and the dumpster fire that is 123. And although I don't currently have a paid membership on 123, and I haven't had a paid membership on 123 for several years, I have always maintained a free profile because I do think that there is a benefit to that. When I'm doing my own marketing, if a company says we only cast through 123, at that point I have the ability to say, well, I'm not an active member, but I do have a profile, and here's the link to my profile. If you want to add me to your favorites list, feel free to send me a private audition. I'll audition for anything you want on that site. And that works. It works all the time. So just because you don't have a paid membership on 123 doesn't mean that you can't still benefit from the site. And to dig a little bit deeper into that, check out this great story from Rebecca Webster.
I just wanted to call and leave you a message and tell you a little bit about how I was on a pay-to-play website and I wasn't even using the fully subscribed, so I wasn't paying for my membership. It was in the early days of me trying to figure out how to start doing voiceover, and I just got a direct email and a client wanted my voice for a medical explainer video. And I wrote them right back and we negotiated. And the following week, I was in a studio recording a medical voiceover for hepatitis C. So I think sometimes it's good when you're just learning to consider things like pay to play, but do it well. Because obviously the strength of my demo had really gotten through to them, and they figured out that that voice was what they wanted. They didn't even ask me for an audition, actually. They just heard the demo, sent me an email, and that was that.
I want to point something out here about Rebecca's story. Yeah, Rebecca said that she was getting started, but she also said that her demo spoke for itself, and that's the difference maker. If you are just getting started and you don't have great demos yet, you should not be putting a free profile up on 123 because you are going to misrepresent yourself. and potentially make a bad first impression for anybody that is listening to your bad demos. Casting sites are not the place to practice, okay? You can't practice with other people's actual work. Remember, these are companies that are genuinely trying to hire professional voice actors, and I don't think it's very professional for you to practice on their projects. So even though Rebecca was getting started out, she had quality demos that she was able to put up on the site, and it's those quality demos that led to the work. That is the difference maker. I talked about this in an earlier episode. Do not use casting sites for practice, and do not get yourself up there on the sites until you are ready, until you have demos that genuinely reflect what you can do. That is so important. Now, one of the things that inevitably is going to come up is people are going to want me to tell them what sites are good, what sites are bad. And although I do that all the time in private messages on Facebook and through private email and whatnot, not really in a public forum do I often speak out in that manner because I don't want to get myself into trouble. But what I can say is there are two sites that I can happily endorse at this stage of the game. I have no problem directing people to VO Planet. I have had conversations with Kevin. I see the way that Kevin is working on the business. I see the way that Kevin is operating the business. We've had conversations about the business. I have a membership now. I've only been on the site for about a month or so, but I've had an opportunity to see the site, see the behind the scenes, and see how it works. And I see legitimate jobs. I see legitimate rates. I see the information that I want to see in order to be able to accurately audition for jobs and quote jobs and whatnot. And so I do have no problem saying that VO Planet is legit. That is a site that I can get behind. I also have no problem saying that Bidalgo is legit and that is a site that I can get behind. In fact, I have maintained a membership on Bidalgo for many years now, and this is something I talk about a lot. Even though I don't really use the site, I don't have a lot of time to use the site. I'm doing my own marketing. I'm doing work for my own clients. I don't have a lot of time. I don't sit down for hours every day and do auditions on pay-to-play sites. I just don't have the time for it. But I have so much respect for Armin. Maybe you are familiar with Armin is a rock star. Maybe you don't know the whole backstory of that, but I actually started that. I'm the one that started the Armin rock star thing. It happened via Twitter during a casting site panel at VO Atlanta a couple of years ago when Armin kind of called out VDC and just laid the smackdown on them. And it was beautiful and hilarious. And I've respected Armin ever since. But I do have a membership on Bidalgo, and I have used Bidalgo. I have booked on Bidalgo, and it's the same deal. Legitimate jobs, legitimate rates, and Armin is very responsive to the community. You got to remember with these casting sites that there's two sides to the coin. They have to keep the voice buyers happy, and they have to keep the voice actors happy. And sometimes voice actors forget about that. Yes, technically, we are the ones that are paying for access to the site. And so, you know, a lot of people feel like that makes us the primary client. But you also have to remember that without voice buyers, there's no site for us to pay to be on. So Armin has done an amazing job at balancing both sides. He listens and responds very actively to the voiceover community while simultaneously respecting the needs of the voice buyers. He has been able to find that balance. And that is one of the reasons why I think that Bidalgo is a legit site. And there's somebody else that I know that thinks that Bidalgo is a legit site as well. Somebody who's had a lot of success on Bidalgo, and that is Brad Hyland. Check out what he has to say.
I use a lot of casting site opportunities. It's just one of the ways that I decided to start my business. You know, sometime soon, I'm going to start weaning myself off as I incorporate more and more successful marketing on my own. Part of that is from your advice and the session we had about a year and a half ago. But Bidalgo, the customers that I get from Bidalgo, you know, I book on all the sites that I use, but the customers from Bidalgo just seem to be a really good cut. They continually come back. So almost to the customer, they've asked me to do other projects with them, and they've all been decent paying jobs. I have never had a poor paying job, and if one does show up, I just filter it out and don't respond to it. But basically, just like with any casting site, it can't be the only thing you do. You have to have marketing and you have to have a plan. But for me, the success with Bidalgo is when I get a good script, I make sure it's right in my wheelhouse. And I also don't kill myself on every single audition. by that, I mean, I don't always read the whole script. I find some of the best meat in the script, whether it's the beginning or it's a tag punch at the end, but something that will show the range that they're looking for with within the directions that they've given. And then I make sure every single piece that I send out is broadcast quality sound, matching the exact direction, and making sure that it's a perfect fit for me and my sound. And that seems to do well for me. They don't all get listened to, and they certainly all don't get shortlisted, but I have 25-30% shortlisting percentage. Sometimes it's higher than that. Sometimes it's a little bit lower. But every time that I book a job, the customers are very professional, and it's just ends up being a really good thing.
I want you to pay attention to this one key takeaway from what Brad said. He's very strategic about his auditions. And this is one of the things that I talk about when I do coaching sessions with people, like in one-on-one coaching sessions, and we talk about casting sites. You've got to be strategic. Stop trying to audition for everything, because the reality is that you are not qualified for everything. You don't have the ability to do everything. And if you can limit the number of jobs that you are auditioning for every day, you're going to free up more time to do other things, like your own marketing. But you're also going to increase your booking rate because you're being more strategic about the projects that you are auditioning for. That is one of the things that Brad has done, and that is one of the reasons why Brad is having success. He's not auditioning for everything. He's being strategic, and he's always putting his best foot forward. And that is so important. One of the things that you need to do on your casting sites, if you haven't done it already, is you need to be realistic about what you can book. First of all, it is my opinion that you should not be receiving auditions for any category that you do not have a demo for, because you can't represent yourself accurately in that category without a demo. So if you don't have a demo in audiobooks, don't have it checked off. If you don't have a demo in e-learning, don't have it checked off. If you don't have a demo in video games, don't have it checked off. Only receive auditions for the genres that you have demos for. That is the first place that you need to start. The second thing that you need to do is you need to sit down and look at the data yourself. Where are most of your bookings coming from? And this is something that I did when I was using casting sites years ago. I sat down and I figured out, okay, of all of the jobs that I have booked on casting sites, this percentage was commercial, this percentage was corporate, this percentage was e-learning, this percentage was explainer video, and I tweaked my business plan according to that, because there's a lot of information that comes from that data. And so I think that in order to get more benefit from the casting sites, you need to be strategic in how you're using them. Look at the jobs that you're booking most consistently and prioritize those auditions. If you prioritize those ones, again, you're going to increase your booking rate, but you're also going to save time because you're not auditioning for stuff that you probably shouldn't be auditioning for. And with that extra time that you have now saved from being strategic, get out there and do your own marketing. Get on Google, get on LinkedIn, get on Twitter, get on Instagram. Find your own clients so that your entire business model isn't built on the backs of somebody else's business. You've heard me say it before. You'll hear me say it over and over and over again because it is so important. This is the difference between a voice actor and a VOpreneur. A voice actor is only looking for the audition opportunities. A VOpreneur is looking for those audition opportunities, but understanding at the same time that they are running a business. And that makes a big difference. When you start looking at this as a business, that you are running a business, it changes your approach. It changes the way you think about things, and it changes the way that you operate. That is so important. Now, another thing that we got to talk about with casting sites is you'll go on social media and you'll see that somebody just put a post up on social media. Oh, I just booked this amazing job on 123, or I just booked this amazing job on Bidalgo or whatever. And, you know, they get all excited about this amazing opportunity that they booked. And everybody else is like, oh, you're so lucky. You're so lucky. You're so lucky. That really bothers me. I actually find that to be very disrespectful because I don't think that luck has anything to do with it. I think that skill has everything to do with it. People don't book jobs because they're lucky. People book jobs because they're good. But sometimes after you've booked the job because you are good, it gets a little bit of luck built in after the fact. And to explain that, I want you to listen to this amazing story from Bob Johnson.
Last year, I auditioned for a short spot on Voice 123. It was for a 30-second commercial that required an announcer's voice. So, being that's what I normally gravitate towards, I decided to audition. A couple of weeks later, I got an email that said I was selected for not only that commercial, but they had 24 other additional spots right behind that one, and they wanted to use my voice for all of them. Lo and behold, I said yes and was quite pleased. The really good news story is now that we're at the tail end of that promotional campaign, they actually want to use me for next year's spot as well for another project that they're working on. So this one particular Voice 123 spot has actually turned into almost 48 additional spots that I have to voice for this particular client. So, been a good deal.
Bob didn't book that job because he was lucky. Bob booked that job because he was good. He was the right guy. He was the voice that the client was looking for. Where luck came into play was that, hey, this one-off opportunity has turned into a long-term gig, 24 spots that keeps going. It's the gift that keeps on giving. But know that luck had nothing to do with it. Bob booked the job because Bob was good. That's important to remember. Don't ever take away from another voice actor who books a great job by saying you're so lucky. Bob works really hard at what he does, just like you work really hard at what you do. You practice, you train, you coach, and that is why you're getting the gigs, whether they're through your own marketing or through casting sites. I hope you've been enjoying this week's episode on online casting and enjoying some of the stories from the everyday VOpreneurs just like you. We'll get back to it in just a minute, but first, you know, in this episode, we've talked about how important it is to be able to do your own marketing. And I'm sure you're listening to that and maybe you're thinking, but Mark, I don't know how. But Mark, I'm not a marketer. Let me tell you something. If you have professional demos, if you have a professional home studio, and if you have the performance training, the ability to actually deliver the voiceovers, but you're still not booking, I really truly think the problem is with your marketing. And that is something that can be easily fixed with a little bit of time and effort on your part. Coming up April 9th to 18th, my voiceover marketing playbook is going to be available again. This is my flagship marketing program that I only release a couple of times a year. It is a step-by-step, easy-to-follow video course that is going to give you a clear plan for finding your own leads, building your own client base, and becoming the consistently working voice actor that you want to be. Once again, the playbook is going to be available from April 9th through 18th, and you can check it out when it becomes available at voiceovermarketingplaybook.com. It is a video course that exists online. Once you register, you'll have access to that course instantly, and you'll be able to watch the videos at your own pace. Watch them as many times as you want, and there's a lot of different bonus features that are built into the program as well, which I'll outline more when it becomes available. So mark it on your calendar. I would love to have you in the playbook, and I'd love to have the opportunity to work with you to help you get better at your own marketing so you don't have to rely on casting sites. The playbook, again, will be available from April 9th through 18th. And when it becomes available, you'll be able to sign up at voiceovermarketingplaybook.com.
They call it show business. You know that, right? Everyday VOpreneur, your guide through the business of voiceover.
Go onto Facebook, go onto Twitter on any given day, and you're going to see all kinds of rants and raves about all of the crappy jobs that are popping up on casting sites. Now, this is more prevalent on some sites than others. I know that Kevin and Armin are doing a really good job of monitoring the projects that land on Bodalgo and land on VO Planet. They try to keep those lower jobs away. They're very strict about budgets and minimums and all that sort of stuff. But sometimes you're going to see a job on a casting site that isn't going to sound that glamorous. And we love to complain about this stuff. And I'm not really sure why. Everything needs a voiceover, right? From the most glamorous to the least glamorous. I often talk about the fact that I don't do a lot of sexy voiceover work. You're not hearing me on national commercials. You know, I have the humbling experience every time I meet somebody and they ask me what I do and I say I'm a voice actor. And they say, well, what have I heard you on? And I get to say nothing. Because I do corporates and I do e-learnings and I do explainer videos. And it's, you know, I'm not the voice of a TV show. I'm not the promo guy of a network. I'm not the national voice of a brand. It's not what I do. It's the unsexy voiceover, but it pays really well. And it's given me a living that is multi times better than anything I would have ever gotten in radio. But what I want you to think about is this. Don't just immediately delete an audition that comes across in a casting site because it's not super glamorous. You know, when we see opportunities for animation and for video games in particular, we're looking for those really big, glamorous, sexy titles. But maybe the job that you're auditioning for isn't the most glamorous, but maybe one day it could be. I love this story from Ian Russell.
I set up my voiceover business in 2014 when I moved from the UK to the US. Very early in my online casting auditioning journey, I threw in an audition for a video game. It was maybe 6 or 7 months in, like halfway through 2015 or so, like a mountain of auditions. Some work, but certainly not setting the world alight. You know, I didn't know the name of the game or anything about it. Turned out it was for a very large game, but it was only a small guest appearance, guiding the player through two adventures linked to the release of a remake of the Point Break movie at the end of 2015. Smallish fee, once and done, record, get paid, move on. Anyway, a year later, 2016, I was asked to guest on a charity stream about the game. They'd invited lots of voice actors to come on. I had lots of fun, did lots of silly accents, responded to questions, all that kind of thing, helped raise money for a good cause. Okay, move on. Then in 2017, the studio asked me to reprise the role again, remaking a couple of previous adventures and some new DLC. Then, late 2017, they asked me to take over the main narrator role, NDA, contract, etc., etc. So through 2018, I was recording, like, just about every month. Then they asked me to appear front of camera as the character. So now the character has his own Twitter account, at LockPayday. Clue there. It's got around 5,500 followers. The game is Payday 2. It's one of the largest subscribed games on Steam, available on consoles, etc., Switch. And now we hold our breath to see if Payday 3 will be announced. The character Vernon Locke, and this is what he sounds like, for sure. Not British. But having Locke has most definitely helped me book other significant game roles. So from a small online casting role, this whole thing has exploded.
If Ian had turned down that opportunity because it wasn't some big glamorous role in a video game, Ian would have ultimately missed out on something pretty special. Ian would have missed out on the opportunity that ultimately led to the title character role, a major role in an ongoing series of video games, which is pretty spectacular. And remember, all of these jobs that we're talking about, all of these stories that are being shared by these everyday VOpreneurs, these are all opportunities that have come from casting sites. But they're coming as a result of people who are using casting sites the right way. Not relying on them exclusively, but using them intelligently, using them as a tool towards their business. I'm going to be honest with you. I do not think that it is possible in 2019 to earn a full-time, sustainable six-figure income exclusively off the backs of casting sites. I know a few years ago there were people that were doing it. I'm not convinced that it's possible anymore. And there are a few different reasons for that. One of them is the fact that there are so many talent competing now. And that absolutely makes things more difficult. There are so many talent competing on these casting sites that it's a lot harder to book. That's the first challenge. The second challenge is that there are casting sites that offer tiered membership. And I'm not here to debate tiered membership. Ultimately, it is the casting site's prerogative to run their business how they see fit. Capitalism is capitalism. Everybody's out there looking for a way to maximize profits. And if a casting site chooses that one of their ways to maximize profits is by having a higher tiered membership, that's their prerogative. Voice actors can whine and cry and groan about it all they want, but it's the casting site's prerogative to have those tiered memberships, and it is your prerogative as a voice actor to decide either A, I'm going to get in on one of those higher tiers, B, I am not able to get on one of those higher tiers, but I'll take what I can get on the lower tier, or C, if it bothers you that much, don't do business with them. Run your business your way. Go do your own marketing. Find your own clients. Quit complaining. Okay? Seriously. And I know that sometimes people think that I'm a little bit too blunt or a little bit too harsh, but I think that's part of my responsibility as a coach. My job is not to tell you what you want to hear. It's to tell you what you need to hear. And from a business operational standpoint, there are some hard truths that voice actors need to hear. And part of the reason for that is because voice actors don't tend to operate from the business side of their brain. They tend to operate from the creative side of their brain. And so that's why it's so much easier for them to do the creative things, to do the auditions and the bookings and the castings and all that sort of stuff. But they struggle with understanding the business side of things. So I do think that those tiered memberships make it harder, because, and you can't tell me that they don't. And I would be willing to sit down and debate this with owners of casting sites as well. You can't tell me that they don't have an impact on how things work, because you have no choice but to give preference to the people that are paying the higher tiered membership. And I know that there are systems and strategies that are supposed to be built in to protect against that. And I know that if you anybody can't just go and pay $5,000 and get in, right? You have to be good enough to be at that level. You have to be booking consistently to get in at that level. But by paying at that level on a casting site, it is going to give you a leg up. You're going to see all of the auditions. You're going to see them first. You're going to have the opportunity to get in earlier than everybody else. And one of the things that we know from casting sites is that sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes getting in first can make the difference. Getting in within the first 10 or 15 auditions, you've got a much higher chance of booking than if you're submitting, you know, between 150 and 175. That's just a fact. Everybody knows it. That's just a fact. So I think that there are advantages built in for people who are getting in at the higher tier. And because of that, it can make it more difficult for people at the lower tier to book. I think that we proved repeatedly with VDC that preferential treatment was being given to the people that bought in at the higher tiered membership. That's why when they used to have their recently booked page, you could jump on to the website and you could see who was, you know, recently hired. It was always the same people. Every single time it was the same people. And all of those people were people that were paying in at the higher tier. Project managers were going out and they were using those people. The jobs were getting posted on the casting site just to make everybody feel like they were getting an opportunity to audition. But the reality was somebody else had already been chosen for that job. And there was somebody who previously worked at VDC that basically admitted that that was going on. Project managers had their operating instructions. They had their favorite voice actors, and those were the ones that were booking the jobs. But the auditions were still being posted just so people could feel like they were getting an opportunity. That's one of the reasons why so many of the jobs that were getting posted there, the auditions weren't getting listened to, because somebody else had already been selected right from the very beginning. You have to understand all of this stuff. You have to educate yourself on all of this stuff, and you have to look at it from a business standpoint. You can't purely look at it from a, I paid my $400 and I'm entitled to, or I paid my $400 so I should be entitled to. You've got to look at the business models. You've got to understand how these businesses are operating, and then you have to make a risk analysis. Is it worth it? Is my $400 worth it to get me enough opportunities? And you know, I hear people say all the time, well, if I only book one job, I make my money back. That is so wrong. That is so completely wrong, because you're not looking at things from a business standpoint. Again, this is not a zero-sum game. It's not a matter of, it cost me $400, so as long as I make $400 off the site, then everything balances out in the end. That's not true. Because if you're spending 2 or 3 hours a day on a casting site 5 days a week, okay, we're talking 10 to 15 hours being spent on a casting site every week. If you take those 10 to 15 hours and then you multiply them out over the course of the year, you're spending a crap ton of time on a casting site that you're not spending anywhere else. And if you're only booking enough to pay off your membership, what's your hourly income? Like 2 cents an hour? Is it worth it? You can't just look at the numbers as far as the dollars. You got to look at the time, and you have to figure out what your time is worth. You have to value your time. And so part of your responsibility is sitting down honestly with yourself and saying, I'm spending this many hours on the website, and this is how many bookings it's getting me, and this is how much income it's earning me. And when I divide that out, I'm making this many dollars per hour. And if that number isn't where you want it to be, then maybe the casting site isn't where you should be. Or maybe there's something else at play here. When's the last time you worked with a coach and had somebody assess your auditions? I did that. When my booking ratio started dropping off on casting sites, I booked a session with J. Michael Collins, and I had him listen to my auditions, and we went through them one by one for an hour, and he gave me feedback on each one of them. And I tweaked my approach a little bit, and then I started booking again. So you have to pay attention to the data. Remember, you are running a business, and businesses run on data. You make smarter decisions when you're paying attention to the data. It's not just about earning back your annual membership. It's about how many hours a day you're spending and how much that is ultimately banking for you. We love the instant gratification of casting sites. We love the fact that I went on a casting site today and I submitted 5 auditions. And so you feel like you did something. And you did. And we don't get that same kind of feeling when we send emails, when we do email marketing. We don't get that same kind of feeling because we didn't actually go in the booth and record anything. We just sent an email. What I want to challenge you with is to change your perspective. Every time that somebody listens to your demo, think of that as an audition. And so whether you submitted 5 custom auditions on a casting site or you emailed 5 people and had 5 people listen to your demos on your website, that's still 5 auditions. We've got to change our perspective on our own marketing. That's the only way that we're going to be able to slowly start to wean ourselves off of casting sites. And keep in mind, when I say wean yourself off of casting sites, I'm not saying you can't use them anymore. I'm just saying weaning yourself off so that maybe your business model is more like 60% marketing and 40% casting. Or maybe it's 70% marketing and 30% casting. Or maybe you're going to be like me and you're going to get yourself to a point where it's like 95% my own marketing, my own clients, and 5% casting sites. That is why you don't see me having a fit when somebody screws something up on a casting site, when the rules change on a casting site, because my business is not reliant on them. That said, there are still some great opportunities out there. You are going to get access to jobs through the casting sites that you're not going to be able to get by yourself, because there are still people that are going to use them. They provide a valuable service. They make the process of casting easier for people who don't have the time to do it or who don't understand how it works. And somebody like Dan Harder, who is an everyday VOpreneur that is connected in the group, he's had a lot of success on casting sites. He's had a lot of really great clients that have come as a result of casting sites. He understands that those great opportunities are out there, but he also understands that it can't be the only tool in his toolbox. But as he's worked on these casting sites and as he's booked off of these casting sites, he's been strategic. He's been smart about the jobs that he's auditioning for. And I want you to listen very closely to this really great story from Dan.
I got to say, pay-to-plays have been good for me. Casting sites and pay-to-plays, that has been my primary business model through the years. And learning now with the changes at Voice123, that can't be. I've got to develop my own business. But I've looked at them more as dating sites, you know, looking for the long-term relationship rather than the one-off, hey, use my voice for this one thing. Two stories come to mind as I think about the pay-to-play or casting sites. One, within a couple of weeks of signing up at Voice123 back in 2007, I landed a client who has come close to paying my mortgage every month since 2007. That has been a great gig. I love it. It's safety training. That's been a real exciting job. And I've done hundreds of hours of material for them. And really, it's helped me become somewhat of an expert in safety things. I can tell you a lot of things about safety, industrial safety, that I would never have known. And then the second story that comes to mind, late in 2017, I auditioned for a healthcare commercial and landed that one. That has turned into a huge job. Most of my work has been corporate stuff, internal, non-broadcast type of material. But these things are commercials that have aired in the northeastern United States. And some of those, in fact, in 2018, two of the commercials won Effie Awards, which is unusual for two commercials in the same year from the same organization to win Effie Awards, but that happened. And they have come back to me again. In fact, to come up next month, we got another scheduled session for their summer campaign. So that has been a very profitable endeavor.
I love the fact that he says that he treats it like a dating site. This is one of the things that I often teach in coaching sessions. Look for the people who have the opportunity to come back to you again. It's going to be really hard for you to build a sustainable business off of one-off opportunities. In order to build a sustainable business, you need to get connected with clients who are going to provide you with multiple opportunities. And that's exactly what Dan says that he's looking for. And that's exactly what Dan has been finding. And one of those has turned into award-winning commercials. which is pretty amazing. Tell me how great that looks on a resume when you're reaching out to people, when you're reaching out to an agent, or when somebody's looking on your website and trying to decide whether or not you're legit and you have the ability to say that you have voiced award-winning spots. Thanks for that story, Dan. I love it. And so all of this goes to show you that there are incredible opportunities on the casting sites. Nobody is disputing that. All I'm saying is that you can't rely on them exclusively. Make sure that you are still building in time to do your own marketing. Make sure that they are not the only tool in your toolbox. And make sure that you are using the right sites. I said earlier, I can endorse VOPlanet. I can endorse Bidalgo. A lot of people have asked me about voiceovers.com. I can't speak to it specifically yet because I haven't seen it. I haven't used it. I don't know a whole lot about it. What I do know is what I've read online. I think that Matt has a completely legitimate business plan. I think that Matt is doing things the right way. I think that he is coming to the table with a realistic budget for advertising. He's got a solid strategy in place. I think that he's doing everything behind the scenes from a business standpoint to set himself up for success in the online casting space. Now it's just a matter of waiting to see how it all plays out. There's a lot of competition. I don't know how many casting sites that the voiceover industry can sustain. And right now we've got a lot of them. I do know that if I was going to start a casting site, there was never a better time to get into it just because of all of the stuff that is going on behind the scenes with VDC and 123. For years, they were the only game in town. They were the big players. VDC has obviously lost a lot of respect within the industry. I think that they are hurting for quality talent based on things that I have heard and seen and read. And obviously, there's a dumpster fire going on at 123 right now that they are trying to get sorted out. And until they get that sorted out, they are continuing to lose talent and they are continuing to lose buyers. And those buyers are going to go somewhere to find their voiceover work. And that is either going to be to another casting site or they are going to start to build their own rosters of talent, eliminating the casting sites. And that means that there's an opportunity for you to do your own marketing. So you've got to have balance. You can't just use the casting sites. Make sure that you're still doing your own marketing. And when I know more about voiceovers.com, when I've had a chance to check that site out, looking forward to the casting site panel that's going to take place at VO Atlanta. Hopefully I'll have an opportunity to connect with Matt and talk to him a little bit. You know, maybe I'll have something more to add to that conversation. But for now, I think that you just have to be very smart about where you're investing your dollars in online casting. And I think you have to be very smart about how you use them. I don't think they're all evil. And that's the most important thing that I want to clarify, because some people do think that I feel that way. As we come to the end of the episode, I got one more story that I want to share. You know, we've talked about the fact, or I guess I've talked about the fact, that there's a dumpster fire going on at 123 right now. And talent have been really frustrated over the fact that we're continually making suggestions for improvements, tweaks, etc. And months later, this stuff is not happening. There doesn't seem to be support. Every day, there's another person posting on Facebook how they've sent a message to customer support, haven't got a reply. Made a call to customer support, haven't got a reply. Attempted to talk to customer support through a chat, haven't got a reply. There are still sites out there that respect the voice actors, and they get back to the voice actors. Check out this story from Kevin McAdams.
I had basically decided not to mess with pay-to-play sites at all. After investing a good portion of my retirement in coaching and equipment and demos, it just wasn't in my budget. And plus, I heard all the horror stories and seemed like nobody really had a good word to say about it. So I just decided I was going to get by without it for now. But then VOPlanet opened up, and then I saw that a lot of the people that I've been following and that I'm looking up to in this business had endorsed it. So I looked at it, and for the $149 introductory rate, I figured, you know what? I book one job, it pays for itself. So I signed up. My login didn't work though. So I jumped onto the website and fired up their chatbot and reached out for support. I didn't get an immediate answer. So I jumped on Facebook, went to the VOPlanet Facebook page and sent a private message that way explaining that I'd signed up but my login wasn't working. No sooner had I done that than I go back over to the website and they're answering me. So this was like less than a minute all told. And they told me, okay, we fixed it. Try it now. I did, and it worked. I went on, got signed up, and actually got my very first audition that same night.
I can vouch for what Kevin says because of this. A couple of days ago, I came across something on VO Planet, and I thought, you know what? This is something that might be able to be improved a little bit. And so I sent a message to Kevin West of VO Planet, and I offered him my suggestion. He replied almost instantly, thanked me for the suggestion, said that it was a really good idea, and said that he was going to start looking for ways immediately to implement it. And so I respect that. I respect customer service that listens to its customers and then does something about it, right? It's not enough to just listen, but to actually listen and do something about it. And that is one of the things that I have seen repeatedly from Kevin, very active on social media, always responding to talent, always looking for ways to improve the site and improve the experience for voice actors. And that is something that I have always seen from Armin, which is one of the reasons why he is one of the most beloved people in our industry, because he listens to the talent, but he takes it a step further. He implements. He doesn't just listen, he implements. And I think he's in an advantage because he's running the show. He doesn't have to go through 14 meetings and 75 committees and 6 months of back and forth to try to figure out how to do something. We go to Armin, we say, Armin, what about this? He's like, okay. And then tomorrow he's got it done. And I think that Kevin has been, you know, he's shown the same kind of response to his customers. And so that's one of the reasons why I can fully endorse VOPlanet and Bidalgo as well. And so there are still sites out there that are listening. There are still sites out there that care about the voice actors. And there are still sites that are responsive to what we have to say. As we go forward, as we watch how all of this casting site stuff evolves and grows and new players come into the game, all I can say is that you have to remember at the end of the day, you can't just look at this as a voice actor. You have to look at the casting site business and understand how they are structuring their business, because it's going to help you to better make an educated decision on what you want to do as far as membership or not membership. And then you also have to look at your own business and figure out how the casting site is going to incorporate into your business, not become your whole business. Guys, thanks so much for checking out another episode of the Everyday VOpreneur podcast. I want to say a big thank you to Rebecca Webster, to Bob Johnson, to Brad Hyland, Ian Russell, Dan Harder, and Kevin McAdams, all of who shared stories today, all of who are everyday VOpreneurs that are out there every day trying to run their own businesses. And thank you so much for being active in the Everyday VOpreneur community, for responding to the questions and the status updates that I post there, and for taking the time out of your day to record and to share your story with us. And I hope that you guys all continue to have great success as you move forward on your casting sites. Don't forget that Everyday VOpreneur podcast is available everywhere fine podcasts are given away for free. You can subscribe on iTunes, on Google Play, on Podbean, on Stitcher, on Spotify. I would love it so much if you would take the time to leave a review, and it would warm my heart, and I mean that with all sincerity, if you would take the time to share this podcast with your friends through Facebook, through Twitter, through other forms of social media. Let them know, spread the word that the Everyday VOpreneur podcast is out there and that I'm going to do my best always to bring genuine, transparent authenticity to the podcast and to tell the stories of the everyday VOpreneurs that are out there trying to make a living, trying to build a business, and trying to have success in voiceover. Thanks again for listening. Catch you on the next one.
The Everyday VOpreneur podcast, available everywhere fine podcasts are given away for free. Mostly, we think.
Your number one marketing tool is your voiceover demos. When sending out demos or posting them online, you want to be sure they're playable on any device and with any browser. VoiceZam's demo player does exactly that. Plus, it offers your listeners more flexibility than a traditional audio player. Sign up at msvo.me/msvoicezam and receive 3 months of VoiceZam for the price of one. Sign up now at msvo.me/msvoicezam.
The VOpreneur Podcast. Hey, it doesn't suck.
And that's a wrap. Thanks for hanging in. Thanks for hanging out. Want more VOpreneur goodness? Jump online at VOpreneur.com.